So that they might go and anoint Jesus' body. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone from us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place where they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. British show into maybe an equivalent American show. Up until The Sweeney, every police procedural drama had been really easy to follow. There were good guys, there were bad guys, and the bad guys always got caught by the time the final credits rolled. In The Sweeney, which incidentally is Cockney rhyming slang, Sweeney Todd Flying Squad, it was a particular branch of Scotland Yard. In The Sweeney, the bad guy didn't always get caught. And sometimes the good guys weren't always good. And sometimes you had to try real hard to figure out who was the good guy and who was the bad guy. And I'm seeing nods, so I know that you can figure out the American show that was kind of equivalent in your life. That transition point into, well, for want of a better word, realism. I say that to you because Mark's Gospel is the equivalent of that TV show. Mark's Gospel is down and dirty. Mark's Gospel is roughly written. In the original Greek, it's not very polished. It's short and sharp and to the point. It's a little like most of the other Gospels. You know what Pastor Wogan and I are like? If three words will describe it, Eric and I will use 10 words. And that's what the other Gospels are like, Matthew and Luke and John. They're really quite flowery, and they're detailed and very polished, but Mark not, short, sharp, to the point. And Mark's gospel, when it comes to the Passion and the Resurrection, is really pretty blunt. I mean, if you ever find yourself with a spare moment, look at the Passion and Resurrection accounts of all four gospels, one after the other. You'll see how different Mark's is. Short and to the point, and really quite dark. Notice in Mark's gospel, at the crucifixion, none of the men are present. Not even one. At least in John's gospel, the beloved disciple is there. But no man who is a follower of Jesus is present at the crucifixion. All of the men talked a great game. I mean, they sounded like they knew what they were doing. They sounded like they were in it for the long haul. But they're all gone. And Peter, the one who is the loudest and brashest of all voices, is the one whose voice loudly declares that he's never even met Jesus. Doesn't even know the man. Couldn't even pick him out of a crowd. Peter, the loudest of voices declaring his love, turns out to have the loudest voice of denial. And it's in Mark's gospel that we have the cry of dereliction. That in Mark's gospel, the words of Jesus from the cross are not, "It is completed." The words of Jesus on the cross in Mark's gospel are, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Now, in Mark's gospel, the women go to the tomb, and they are heartbroken. You can feel it, it's palpable. Everything that they have loved is gone. And unlike the men who will hear about Christ's death second, third, fourth, fifth hand, they watched it. They were witnesses of it. They have been traumatized by it. Everything they love is gone. And now they're going to the tomb with spices, in a vain hope that they can wrap the body in sweet-smelling spices to ward off the stench of death, which may have already begun. And then, if that's not enough, on top of all that, what's weighing heavily on their mind as they approach the tomb is the realization that they might not even be able to anoint Jesus, because they have no idea who is going to move that great big rock from the front of the tomb. Even a lump of stone is going to defeat them. Even a lump of rock is going to break their hearts even more. By the time they reach the tomb, they are as broken as a person can possibly be broken. And then the gospel turns. Because then, the first chink of light is that the stone has been rolled away. The second one is that a man in brilliant white appears. And let me just tell you, in sacred scripture, anytime someone robed in white appears, it's a good sign. Okay? You don't have to wonder, is this a good guy or a bad guy? Anyone in the New Testament robed in white is okay. And then he has a proclamation for them that Christ has risen. He is not there, and he will meet them in Galilee. And then there's another chink of light. The women are made the first apostles. The word apostle means one who is sent. And the angel sends them with a message, with a gospel message. The women are to be the first apostles. They are to go to the disciples and tell them that Jesus is alive. They have been given a mission. And in the hands of any other gospel writer, that would be a wonderful way to end. We would all say, "Ah, isn't that sweet? The good guys get to win. All's well." But Mark tells his story, tells Jesus' story, with brutal realism. The women are still afraid and fearful. and they flee from the tomb in terror. And they said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. And Mark's gospel ends there. It's such an abrupt and dark ending that many people down through the centuries have thought to add bits to Mark's gospel to make it a wee bit more palatable, to end on a high note, give the crowd what they're looking for, a good ending. But that's how it ends. So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. And they're in good company, because that's us. Can't you see yourself in that account? We come in here every Sunday with the weight of the world on our shoulders. We talk a good game. We pretend to each other all fine. You walk in the doors of the church and someone says, "How are you?" And you lie through your teeth. You say, "I'm fine, how are you?" And they lie through their teeth by saying, "I'm great." If you ever think that people are not lying, try telling them the truth for a change. See how long you keep their attention. "How am I? Ah, let me tell you." Pour your heart out and see what the reaction is. Some of you here are too young to know heartache and heartbreak. Some of you are too young to know what it's like to lose a job, or lose a house, or lose a job and a house, or lose a spouse to death or infidelity, or to have a family member that you pray every waking moment for because they are in trouble. They are in trouble with the law, or in trouble with some substance, and you remember them as they were, as children with bright promises and bright futures, but now you pray for them with every ounce of energy you have. Or you mourn them because they have gone before you in faith. And quite how you ever get out of bed in the morning to face any day is a victory of the human spirit in the face of loss and grief. And yet we come every week to church, and we hear again the gospel and the proclamation of life and of freedom, and the proclamation of liberty from bondage to sin and death. And then we leave and we say nothing to anyone because we're afraid. We've met the risen Lord in the bread and wine of his body and blood in Holy Communion. We've heard those forgiving words spoken to us in absolution. We hear the good news of God in Christ Jesus. But we too often leave here and say nothing to anyone, for we're afraid. We're afraid we'll sound like a religious fanatic, or we're afraid that they'll be offended by our message, or we're afraid that we'll look foolish, or we're afraid we won't use the right words, or we're afraid to even open our mouths. We're afraid. But there's good news. Because, okay, Mark's gospel ends brutally, honestly, and abruptly. But we know that they did tell someone. Eventually, we know that the disciples would still get the wrong end of the stick, and one of them would doubt that Jesus was raised until he actually sees it for himself and puts his finger in the hole in his side and the finger in the holes of Jesus' hands. But we know that they will eventually get it. We know that they will share the good news of God in Christ Jesus. We know they'll share it because we know it. We've heard the good news. We've heard the gospel. We've had it proclaimed to us. We've had it enacted before our very eyes in the sacraments and in worship and in love. So they do speak. Their fear is eventually overcome and they find their voice. But I think the strength of the honesty with which Mark ends his gospel is that we are left in no doubt whatsoever that their voice comes to them not because of their own inherent goodness or righteousness. Their voice doesn't come to them because they've pulled themselves up by their bootstraps. Their voice doesn't come to them because every day in every way they're getting better and better as people. Their voice doesn't come to them because they've figured out the magic formula for a good life if you just give it enough effort. Their voice comes to them, must only come to them, through the power and grace of the Holy Spirit working in their hearts and working on their lips. They find their voice because God continues to love them and the risen Christ continues to reach out to them. And he does to us. There's the good news for today, in addition to the resurrection from the dead. God in Christ Jesus, through the power of the Holy Spirit, will work in us, does work in us, does work through us, does come upon us. And we will find our voice as we find the ability to pray for our loved one in prison. As we find the voice to pray for our wandering child. As we find the courage to face a new day without a daughter or a son. As we deal with the uncertainties of life, we are filled with joy through the Holy Spirit, knowing that the blood of the Lamb, which freed our sisters and brothers of the Jewish faith when they were in bondage to slavery in Egypt, that the blood of the Lamb at Passover gave them freedom. Freedom from slavery and the freedom to enter the land promised to them. And that the blood of our Lamb, Christ Jesus, spilled on the cross for our sake while we were yet sinners, frees us from bondage to sin and to death, and gives us the freedom to enter into our promised land, the eternal banquet at the feast of the Lamb, in the heavenly places, where we meet our risen Savior face to face, where sin and death have been trampled underfoot by the victorious Lord of all. In the resurrection of Jesus Christ, through the empty tomb, through the words that still question us of why we seek the living among the dead, and the deep and abiding and joyful and awesome realization of the truth and the reality that he is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Amen.